We're expecting a couple of mountain bike riders who've crashed their bikes. The fact we're getting two is interesting. Maybe they're in a race. Do you remember much about the crash?
I remember going over my apple bars and then I sort of blacked out until I was lying on the ground. I landed face first.
We might need to straighten out this wrist.
Oh, God. Oh, please.
Ollie? We really can't wait to sit on this, so we need to get this addressed tonight.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself, when I need your love? If I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I'm slipping under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you get my back?
We're going to staple your head back together.
There is a possibility he might die. Would you rescue me?
Okay, so you're all right?
Yeah.
Hi.
Hi. Jonathan.
Is she going to ICU? Or...
Yeah.
So you're okay? All right, good.
It's a busy morning at Royal Melbourne Emergency, and Senior Dr Jonathan Papson is in charge of a rush of trauma patients.
Some days it's just accident after accident. It's non-stop. Some days it's like a war zone.
Disaster.
Traumas tend to come in bursts, and who knows when it's going to stop? Probably when I go home.
A call has come through from paramedics bringing in two injured teenagers by air ambulance.
We're expecting a couple of mountain bike riders, kids who've crashed their bikes. One's got arm injuries and one's got leg injuries. These aren't trivial injuries when you break bones. You can go pretty quick on a mountain bike and you can go pretty high and you can come down pretty hard. So there probably is more to it. The fact we're getting two is interesting. Maybe they're in a race or something, I don't know.
The teenage mountain bikers crashed in separate accidents just minutes apart.
That's one of them.
Dr. Jonathan will lead the team in Trauma Bay 1. Next door in Trauma Bay 2, Dr. Ali Al-Jabouri will look after 16-year-old Ollie, who has a badly broken leg.
Ollie?
Hello.
My name is Ali. I'm one of the doctors.
Jonathan is treating the other 16-year-old Ryan, who's diabetic and has an insulin pump.
What insulin do you have in your pump, mate?
Novorapid.
No COVID risk.
Great, thank you. So this is one of the mountain bike ones?
Yeah.
So this is Ryan, 16-year-old male, lives at home with family. Today was up at a mountain bike park, was on a rolling section, went over a double jump at about 30 kilometres an hour.
It's a high-speed, high-impact injury, so we have to be ready for more motorbike-like injuries. There's a chance for other more serious injuries, head injuries, neck injuries, truncal injuries.
We're seen to go over the handlebars at the crest of that jump, landed about 8 metres away from the jump.
If he was 8 metres in the air, that's a big jump.
Heavy head strike, landing with both arms out. Obvious deformity of bilateral wrist. Initial LOC, just a little bit confused.
LOC is loss of consciousness. That's a warning sign for us that something nasty has happened. A fair fly through the air.
Yeah.
Smacked his face, neck, but most of his wrist. Okay, beautiful, thank you. So I'm just going to very gently unwrap your wrists.
Yeah.
The ambulance tells us you've got broken wrists. You're in a lot of pain?
My right's definitely lost my left.
Yeah. And do you remember much about the crash?
I remember going over the jump like I would normally, and then I just remember going over my handlebars, and then I sort of blacked out until I was lying on the ground.
Sounds like you bashed your head.
Yeah, I landed face first. I was wearing a full face helmet, so.
Yeah, lucky, eh?
I'm happy I did.
And your wrist, can you move your wrist?
It feels like all the muscles are really tight.
Yeah.
Oof.
Yeah. Okay, all right. So you got a little fracture in that one. Yeah. And the other person who came with you, were they in the same race?
I crashed before him, then they took a different trail, and then he crashed on that trail.
Alright.
Next door in Trauma Bay 2, 16-year-old Ollie has a severely injured leg after crashing his bike on a separate run.
Ollie's got collarbone fracture. He's all tip.
Yep.
Parents are aware they're on the way down.
I believe he's gone over a jump, crashed, fractured his right leg in significant pain. So he's had ketamine, fentanyl, IV paracetamol.
Yep.
Ollie's parents are 4 hours away, travelling by car to reach him.
Okay, so we'll do a quick x-ray for your leg. It looked like you broke the two bones of your leg. Sometimes these kind of injuries, we need just to put you to sleep or more like to snooze and get some casts and just to hold the bones together, okay?
Did you see double at all?
Ollie's got a nasty fracture of his lower leg. He's broken both bones in the leg and his leg's actually out of alignment and out of place. With the leg broken at an angle, it's going to be agony until it's straight again.
Next door, Ryan will need his broken wrists put back into place.
I think we need to reposition this wrist for you.
Reposition?
Yes.
Relocate?
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, God.
That's the same.
Oh, please. I've had to have my thumb relocated before, and that was really bad.
Ryan's had a bad experience before, so the minute people are talking fractured bones, potential for relocation, it's all coming back to him. So we've got to deal with that.
Oh, please. Oh, God.
Katie, what time are you here until?
Emergency doctor Scott Taylor is getting ready for an unusual case about to arrive on another air ambulance.
Snake bite.
Snake bite?
Yeah, snake bite.
Yeah, right.
Vomiting and dizzy.
Yikes.
She was winched out of somewhere.
Okay. How far off are they?
Coming in the chopper.
We're expecting a young female in her early 30s who's apparently been bitten by a snake, and she's reporting a headache with some vomiting and feeling generally unwell, which might be a sign that she's been poisoned.
Dr. Scott has treated snake bite victims in country hospitals, but it's rare in the city. So he's preparing the team for all possibilities.
I got the brown snake antivenom.
Do we have tiger as well?
Yep.
We probably won't know, and in all likelihood, we'll probably have to give one brown, one tiger.
Yeah.
Both brown and tiger snakes are potentially fatal. They're amongst the most poisonous snakes in the world. Both of those can cause a patient to bleed and bleed very quickly and in places where we can't stop the bleeding.
30-year-old Ree, a paramedic, was rescued from bushland and rushed to the Royal Melbourne.
Brianna, Ray.
Ray, I'm Scott, one of the emergency doctors. How are you feeling at the moment?
Pretty shit.
Not feeling great?
Just a bit lightheaded.
Have you vomited?
Twice.
Okay. Tummy pain, headache?
Bit of a headache.
Okay.
So Ree's out running today. She ran about 6Ks. She was looking at her phone and has stepped onto a brown snake and it's bitten her on the back of her right leg. She has had considerable pain in her right calf and has required 250 mics of IV fentanyl. Nobody's visualised the wounds, but Bree herself says there's two obvious bite marks in that spot.
Great.
Thank you.
No worries. You've wrapped it with a singlet.
I took my singlet off. That's where the bite is. And then I grabbed a jumper out of my bag and wrapped that as well.
Okay.
Calling on her paramedic skills, Ree used her running gear as a bandage to slow down the venom seeping into her bloodstream.
And we're assuming it was a brown snake just on visualisation.
Yeah, just a big, fat, light brown.
If it is a brown snake, the thing we worry about is bleeding. It basically chews up all your clotting factors and you can bleed.
Yeah.
And obviously we don't want that.
No.
Want to cut a little window and see what that bite site looks like. Where this X is, I'm guessing?
Yeah.
What we're looking for is to see what that bite site looks like, particularly whether there's any ongoing oozing from that site. The venom from the snake bites can chew up all the proteins in your blood that helps your blood clot. So without those, patients can bleed uncontrollably because there's nothing to actually help that blood clot.
That's more worried about your right wrist that they think is out of place. So anyway, we'll have a look.
In Royal Melbourne Emergency, Senior Dr Jonathan Papson is treating two teenage mountain bikers. In Trauma Bay 2, 16-year-old Ollie has a badly broken leg.
we might need to straighten out this wrist.
Next door, Ryan has fractured both his wrists and was knocked unconscious when he crashed his bike.
I have previously had to have my thumb relocated, so...
Yeah, no, we won't have your weight. We'll sedate you if we need to do it. Yeah.
I think it must be pretty bad for the kids, actually, to come into an adult hospital. If you're a 16-year-old kid, really, you probably want your parents with you, not all these strange adults who keep coming in and asking you questions. It'd be pretty frightening, I'd say.
Ryan and Ollie were airlifted off Victoria's Mystic Mountain. Their parents are driving 4 hours to be with them.
Can you feel your fingers?
Yeah, I can feel them.
Yeah, good.
I can move them.
Good, good, good. Yeah. Any limb injury, you can lose the blood supply of the limb, you can hurt the nerves. And because of the high speed, we are more worried.
And that one's all the way up to my elbow.
Is it? Yeah.
That whole arm, not just the wrist.
Right.
Ooh.
This is more sore though, isn't it?
Yeah.
All right, well, what we might do is put some slabs on both wrists. Just gonna check on the other guy.
We'll get the pan scan and then we need to do some reduction on some cast and let the healers.
Mine's got broken wrists, but so you're gonna go to scan, I'll go to scan.
Ali and I are working side by side, so we will often confer. One of the great things about working in our emergency departments, we can share stories about what happened to each other's patients.
And head injuries, yours got a head injury or not?
No head injury, but we'll scan the head.
Right, mine's got GCS 13.
Okay.
It's improved, so I might go first.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Dr. Jonathan's main concern is if Ryan injured his head when he hit the ground.
He was also knocked unconscious for a short period of time. He was drowsy and not quite right for a little bit with his dad, so we will have to scan his head. Have you had any operations or anything?
No.
Nah.
Never had anything like this.
Mm. Yep, just unlucky today, weren't you? Yeah, we'll sort it out for you.
Ryan and his dad were wearing GoPro cameras on their helmets, which recorded the horrific accident.
Oh, Matt, tell him to get help.
Just ring an ambo.
Hey, hey, Ryan, stay still. Stay still, stay still, stay. Stay still, stay still. Stay still. Just straighten up.
Oh, my arms.
Huh? Okay. What did you hit the ground with first?
Oh, my head.
Your head.
Just keep your head still. Keep your head still. Just relax.
But occasionally people bash their head and then a couple of hours later they slip into a coma. So that's why we need to make sure he's getting a scan.
It just seems to be an endless layer here. It's amazing. It's like it's so good.
Dr. Scott Taylor's patient, paramedic Ree, was jogging when she was bitten by a suspected and potentially deadly brown snake.
We're going to need to put some of this back on.
Ree is complaining of a headache. She's had some nausea and a couple of vomits and feeling a bit dizzy, and she probably has absorbed a significant amount of venom.
Just a little bit tricky. It's kind of folded over on itself.
Dr. Scott's looking for the snake bite by cutting through the bandaging remade with her singlet and jumper.
Can actually, there's even more layers under here.
I'm looking at Ree's improvised bandage and thinking, oh my God, this is the most amazing thing that I've ever seen.
I think this is the last one.
Yeah. It's so thick and so effective.
I still can't find it.
I think I'll be hitting the footy club up for a new jumper.
I think so.
Today's the first day
out
worn
it. Oh, no.
There's a little bit of bruising there, but I can't see any obvious puncture marks there.
There's definitely
two
there.
Oh, hang on. No, that's a tattoo.
Okay. I might come back to this, I think. Can we just put another bandage just over the foot?
Yeah.
Start there.
The tight bandage is delaying the spread of poison, and Dr. Scott doesn't want to risk loosening it. The priority now is to give Ree the antivenom.
Do you have any questions before I duck off?
I don't think so.
Okay, all right, I won't be long.
Thank you.
All right.
My impression is that she has not only been bitten by a snake, but potentially has been envenomed by the snake. And it's important that we get some advice from our on-call toxicology service about the best way forward.
Both of the antivenoms in one bag. Okay.
They're stuck in the tissues. That's the whole point of pressure immobilisation, is to keep the venom bound up in the tissues.
Yep.
Deputy Director of Emergency, Steve Pincus, has a lot of experience in treating snake bites.
While I was finishing my emergency medicine training, I did a research registrar post for 12 months at the Australian Venom Research Unit. So I developed an ongoing interest in envenomation in its many forms.
He said the longer you wait, the less likely it is to work. I've cut a window about this big and I still can't find the actual bite.
Yeah, you might. When a snake's biting a person, it's a defence bite. And so they don't classically produce the two beautiful pin marks. Most of the time, it looks like a scratch. Once you start the antivenom, you can actually take the pressure mobilisation down.
OK. Easy. Thank you.
Dr. Scott explains that the antivenoms can have side effects.
So the toxicologist said we should crack on and give one vial of each. The longer we leave it, the less likely it is to be effective. With the antivenom itself, there's a risk of something called serum sickness. Yeah. So fevers, joint aches, pains, rashes, which can happen up to a couple of weeks down the track, or any sort of immediate allergic reactions ranging from rash to anaphylaxis.
Yeah.
I think being a paramedic and having almost certainly seen her fair share of anaphylactic reactions in the past, I'm sure this information's quite unsettling to Ree. And if I was in her shoes, I'd be terrified. There's the antivenom for tiger snake, and there's an antivenom for brown snake mixed in the same bag. And we run that over 30 minutes, and that should neutralise any of the toxin that's been absorbed into the bloodstream. We try and be very selective in who we administer antivenom to because there's a high risk of patients having allergic reactions to the medication. And that can be anywhere from something as little as a rash to something as severe as a life-threatening anaphylaxis. We're about 20% of the way through it, so.
In Royal Melbourne Emergency, snakebite victim Ree has been given antivenom for both the dangerous brown and tiger snakes. Dr. Scott Taylor is on alert for any sign of serious side effects.
You still feeling okay?
Yeah.
How's the headache going?
Still there.
Nausea?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's that lightheaded, fuzzy feeling.
Yeah.
It's an anxious half-hour wait to see if 30-year-old Ree has a bad reaction.
Ree was planning on going out for a run and the next minute she's being choppered into a hospital in the middle of Melbourne and being given antivenom and being told that she's high risk of having an anaphylactic reaction. It must be mind-blowing and something I'm sure she didn't anticipate waking up with in the morning. Howdy.
Venom is finished.
And she's still good?
Yep.
Excellent. All right, we should hopefully have some bloods to check now. Yes, they're all back. Her D-dimer is negative and her coags are normal.
Oh,
good.
There we go. So,
the bandage can come off.
Yep.
I'll come help you cut it off.
Yeah.
Got some good news for you. Blood tests all normal. So no signs of any bleeding disorder. We'll need to repeat your blood test. We don't know what's going to happen over the next hour, 6 hours, 12 hours, which is why we need to keep Ree in hospital for that period of time and repeat the blood tests a couple of times to make sure nothing's changing. Should be a bit easier to cut off now that we can just cut the whole thing. I guess we can have a proper look at that bite site too. So if any symptoms get worse or you get new symptoms, then definitely let us know. This is the most amazing bandage I've ever
seen. Poor jumper.
So what was it? Was it a footy jumper?
Like a rugby top.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's 30, 40 bucks, but considering what it's done for me today, I think it's worth it.
She's potentially saved her own life by cutting up her $40 wind cheater and using it as a makeshift bandage. All right, there we go.
Oh, there it is.
Okay. It's certainly not oozy, and you can still wiggle your toes, all right? Yeah, beautiful. All right, straight in the bin. Get comfy. Have a light stroll around. There's no snakes inside, as far as I know.
Sure.
Might be other things, but as far as I know, there's no snakes.
Ah, that's awesome. Thank you.
She'll certainly need a longer period of observation before we can give her the all clear. But it's better than I thought it was going to be. We've seen a few of these go pretty badly.
Wasn't there a trauma coming? So that's pretty busy.
It's a hectic day in emergency. And Dr. Michael Dunn is waiting for the arrival of a woman who's been trampled by her 300-kilogram horse.
There's a 53-year-old female coming in who's come off a horse and has some low oxygen saturations, which means there might be some lung or potentially some rib injuries as well. No, she's not here. She'll be here in 15 minutes.
Probably spinting.
Colleague Jana Alexander will team up with Michael. The emergency doctors share a common bond.
We're both from Dublin. It's quite nice to have somebody with a familiar accent and understands what it's like to be in, you know, this part of the world.
We've had a lot of horse stuff recently.
They always seem to have big injuries, aren't they? Yeah. If you come off a horse, you tend to fall on, like, your back or your head. Spinal injuries tend to be pretty common, and we only see the worst of the worst.
53-year-old grandmother Belinda was out riding with her family in country Victoria when she was thrown off her horse and trampled. Paramedics have put her on oxygen.
Hi, I'm Michael, one of the doctors. Look after you, okay?
With Belinda, you can tell that she's not breathing adequately, and that's why she needs supplemental oxygen. She's splinting, so she's stopping herself from taking deep breaths to protect herself from pain.
Okay, so we've got 53-year-old Belinda, who's riding a large horse, weighing about 300 kilos, started to buck and she was thrown off. She did get trampled onto her back, with the main impact being on her right scapula. She did say that she felt a large crack, maybe in her mid-thoracic region.
To fracture your scapula requires a lot of force because it's a really well-protected bone. So anyone who comes in with a fractured scapula, you really have to be wary of other major internal injuries.
She might have bumped her head, but the helmet's intact and she's got full recall. Her main complaint is that she's got difficulty when she's taking a big, deep breath. We've kept her on O2 at 10 litres per minute.
OK. There is a suspicion that she has a punctured lung. So if Belinda was left in a situation where she wasn't getting enough oxygen, that can lead to brain injury. And that's something that's pretty time critical. So getting the oxygen level back to a normal level quickly is very important.
Primary?
Yeah.
Definitely decreased breath sounds on the right hand side, yep. But the pressure on last breath, we're just doing it again, and that's not super impressive, so 77/150.
Belinda's oxygen levels aren't the only concern for Dr. Michael. Her blood pressure is also dangerously low.
The worry in someone who's had a traumatic injury with low blood pressure is that it's just bleeding somewhere and we haven't figured out exactly where. How are you feeling at the moment? You feeling a bit dizzy?
No, it's sore.
Just sore. Okay. You get some fentanyl.
Can I just have this right arm?
Sorry, dear. Lift your arm.
What's this?
Okay.
I've got some fentanyl for you. I'm sorry.
I'm going to finish the pass. Yeah. On the chest, we're looking to see if there's lung sliding. So that's going to tell us if there's a pneumothorax, so a collapsed lung.
She's got some air between the chest's wall and the lung itself, and that's causing the lung to collapse, which would be affecting her breathing. Now, it looks like on the right-hand side, okay? There's some air in the chest where it shouldn't be. We're gonna have to pop a tube in to take that air out.
It's my lung tank.
It is, yeah. If we don't put the chest tube in an emergency, that air will continue to expand and that will cause further collapse along, likely a chest infection, and potentially could be life-threatening.
Was it good?
Yeah, it was good until...
Good. It's fun until someone gets hurt, yeah.
Exactly.
Down the corridor, senior doctor Jonathan Papson is treating teenager Ryan, who's broken both his wrists after he was thrown from his mountain bike head first.
Here you go, mate. Mum's here.
Hey.
Who's she?
Ryan's mother and stepfather have arrived in emergency in time to see him before he's taken for a CT scan.
Yeah, been worried about you, mate.
Yeah, it wasn't great.
Come off and do a front flip.
If I wasn't wearing that full face helmet, I probably would have destroyed my jaw. That would have been bad.
Okay.
X-rays
We're gonna take about 5-10 minutes, okay?
Dr. Jonathan gets some background from Ryan's mum about her son's diabetes and the insulin infusion pump attached to his stomach by a tube.
Yes. So his pump's working and everything?
I hope so. With his insulin pump, do you know how many units he runs an hour?
I can look. It's all online.
We just have to watch his sugar. He's got an insulin infusion pump that gives him a continuous supply of insulin that keeps the diabetes under control. It's a great thing. The only catch with an insulin pump is, has it been broken in the trauma? So the only thing at the moment is you didn't have lunch, right? And you may not get dinner. Will this tell us whether it's malfunctioning?
It will. If I go low on high, yes, it will.
Because obviously your pump was in the crash, right? So we won't be feeding him anything. So his sugar will drop, and if he doesn't have the right amount of insulin, he can get very sick very quickly in a matter of hours.
So what we'll do, we'll just let this run itself. The nurses will come and document levels every now and again, and we'll let it do its algorithm, but just don't bolus yourself unless we actually feed you.
The x-rays of Ryan's wrists bring better news.
From the initial shots I've seen of your wrists, neither of them I don't think I need to pull and straighten out. I think it'll just be plasters. I know you're worried about reduction, but you may not be needing that.
Yep. Can I add some water?
No. Not until we know that the rest of your body's all right.
Okay.
We don't know yet, but the reports should come through soon.
Okay.
They said he was sort of dazed and not quite right, and a bit confused initially.
Right.
We're going to scan his head and his neck, given the way he's landed.
Jonathan is overseeing the CT scan. He's concerned about Ryan's head, which hit the ground very hard.
Just looking at scans. Good news, his scans are normal.
The CT scan clears the 16-year-old of any head injuries. But there's still the complication of managing Ryan's diabetes and insulin levels.
He's a type 1 diabetic, so he has no insulin of his own. And if he goes without insulin, he'll get a life-threatening complication called a diabetic ketoacidosis, so it's really serious. And the big scheme of things, a broken wrist is just a broken wrist, but a diabetic ketoacidosis is potentially fatal. That's bolus, yeah, okay, that's right.
That's the basal of our mum.
In Royal Melbourne Emergency, two seriously injured teen mountain bikers are being treated at the same time.
Just give you some medication, we'll put you to sleep, and then we'll apply the cast, okay, because it's a painful procedure.
In Trauma Bay 2, Dr. Ali Al-Jabouri and his team are putting a temporary cast on the badly broken leg of 16-year-old Ollie.
So I won't feel anything under anesthetic.
You'll just have like a 5 or 10 minute snooze.
The leg is sitting at an angle, which is not normal. We're trying to get the leg straight, we're trying to get the nerves and the arteries and the bones all lined up the way they should be, and then it won't hurt as much.
Ollie was airlifted from country Victoria, and his parents are making the 4-hour drive to be with their son.
This is just like a temporary step just to hold the bones together, and then after the CT scan, he will be seen by the orthopedic surgeon.
Because of the way the leg's fractured, there's no way it's going to hold in place. He'll need an operation to fix it.
You okay, Ollie? Just keep eye on him.
Is he off first?
Almost, but very close.
That sounds much better.
Ollie, how are you feeling? You sore?
No.
It's all done. You're waking up. You're still in the hospital. You okay? Does your mom and dad know you're in the hospital or?
Yes, they do.
Okay, are they on the way or?
Yes.
Okay.
Orthopedic specialists are coming to see Ollie. Dr. Papson and Dr. Ali catch up on their teenage patients.
Jonathan, did you get what happened with them, with the accident?
Yeah, so mine crashed and then your guy diverts, goes down another track.
Yes.
And then still crashes.
Okay, interesting.
The temporary cast on Ollie's leg has eased his pain. However, vascular surgeon Dr. Sam Hawthorne has some worrying news.
I can't feel pulses well anywhere there, which in an otherwise healthy young gent such as yourself, I would expect to do. Your other foot has a really strong. Okay.
The absence of a pulse suggests Ollie's artery has been cut off by the fractured leg bone.
If the nerves are damaged or if the blood supply is compromised, you can get permanent nerve damage, so the foot's not going to work properly.
Fractured frame in itself, it's kind of pushing right up against your artery, and that can cause the issues that we're seeing here. Oftentimes, though, it hasn't actually injured the artery itself, so you pull the bone back and everything starts flowing again nicely. But until we've done that, it's really hard to say one way or the other.
It's hard, yeah. I don't know what I would have been doing if I was 16 in that state, but I probably would have been scared to death.
But we have to be prepared for all eventualities, OK?
I'm going to have surgery.
I would think so.
So in Ollie's case, you've got a couple of hours, really, to get him to the operating theatre.
to restore the circulation and the nerve function, to give it the best chance.
It's a pretty nasty injury, actually. The main things we're concerned about is the actual blood flow.
Yeah. Ollie's parents arrive from the site of the accident just as their son is about to be rushed to surgery.
We really can't wait to sit on this, so we need to get on and get this addressed tonight.
Ollie, you're going to go to dinner now, mate, OK?
Now we're here, you understand the gravity and the concerns of the medical issues that they're facing. Being on his own for the last 4 or 5 hours and dealing with the medical teams and the paramedics, I think he's done a great job by himself so far.
He's a good kid and, proud of him.
Parents only get a quick visit with their child before they're rushed off to the operating theatre. You really feel for them. You think, well, what would it be if it was my child? The doctors have said there's a risk that we may have some complications, so that's what they'll be worried about. And it's an anxious wait.
We'll get this off as soon as we can, all right?
Emergency doctors Michael Dunn and Jana Alexander are treating grandmother Belinda, who has a punctured lung and suspected broken ribs after being trampled by her horse.
If we've got an okay-ish CT, then we're going to feel a little bit better about giving her decent sedation.
Exactly, get the CT first and go from there.
Belinda's in terrible pain, but needs a CT scan before Dr. Michael can do a procedure to release trapped air in her chest cavity.
Her right shoulder is extremely sore, so we're going to roll as little as possible just to get this board underneath and we'll go across. On three, one, two, and three. And in, one, two, three. Good, well done. Sounds like it went over, cracked the scapula, probably broken the posterior ribs.
Belinda's scans reveal she's badly injured and has a potentially fatal punctured lung.
So, you can see here, she's gone through all her upper ribs there.
The CT shows she's got extensive rib fractures. And on the right side, she's broken every rib except two and a lot of them in multiple places. So that's a big concern regarding her breathing and also her pain control.
So it looks like we have broken a couple of ribs and, as we suspected, punctured a lung.
On top of that, she's broken her scapula and a small chip of her thoracic spine as well. So she's had quite a significant injury from this.
See you guys around in trauma.
Sure.
Thanks, guys.
When Belinda comes back from CT, she's going to need a chest drain to drain off that air that's outside the lung. The one concern with rib fractures, and that's they're notoriously painful and quite difficult to control.
Can you move this arm out any further than where it is now?
Don't pull it.
Okay, we won't pull it.
No.
Well, it's going to be challenging. We'll give you lots of painkillers.
Hang on, I'll take this bit.
It's really important that we drain off that air because when we get air filling in the gap between the lungs and the chest wall, that can cause someone to essentially die.
So I see trauma's here. Let me know if you need anything.
Anyways.
It's been a full-on day in emergency, and Dr. Miriam Yassa is on her way to see a new patient, 25-year-old painter Brandon, who's fallen 3 metres from a roof.
Very tall.
6 foot.
Yeah. My name's Miriam. I'm one of the emergency doctors. I'm going to be looking after you today.
He was painting on the roof. This morning, he's fallen trying to get on the ladder, standing high 3 metres from the ground.
When I hear 3 metres, that makes me worry. That kind of height. We have to be prepared for the worst.
Okay, busy morning for you, hey?
Hey.
Busy morning.
Yeah.
Okay, so what were you doing up on the ladder?
I was about to hop down because I was painting the spout and then...
You were painting?
The spout.
The
guttering. I was about to hop down the ladder, lost my balance, fell back onto my heels.
Okay, so you land on both your heels first.
When you get a fall from that height onto your legs, the force can cause fractures in the spine. If there's been a lot of damage to the spinal cord, there is potentially damage to the nerves.
You were able to get yourself up again?
Yep.
And what did you do when you got up?
Just relax a little bit because I was shaking.
Yeah.
And then just went to the hospital.
Okay, so you drove yourself into the hospital?
No, my dad did.
And I take it from your clothes, are you a painter?
Yep.
All right. So what we're going to do now is we're going to do an examination, including your back, which means because we've got you in spinal precautions at the moment,
yep.
We need to keep you lying flat on the bed just to make sure we don't move your spine more than we need to.
Yep.
Falling from 3 metres is a pretty significant thing. Yeah. So you're going to have some CT scans as well. Do you have any pain?
My lower back there and my hand. Laying on my finger, I busted that.
Okay.
Any pain doing that?
No.
Any numbness or tingling in your feet?
No.
Where are you sore on your hand, mate?
Right by my finger. Right, this one here, the ring finger.
Can I just, I'm just gonna have a little squeeze. Is it sore there?
No. It's just sore at the top. That's all there.
Can you help us with the leg roll?
Dr. Miriam gathers the team to roll Brandon on his side so she can check his back.
Give yourself a little cuddle, that's the way. We're worried that there might be more serious injuries to his spine.
One, two, three.
Brandon is complaining of back pain, so that is my main concern because a spinal fracture can potentially be devastating.
We're going to begin medication called ketamine. It's going to make you go into the dreamlike stage, just out of it, really.
53-year-old grandmother Belinda was thrown from her 300-kilogram horse and trampled. She has at least 7 broken ribs, a fractured shoulder, and a punctured lung.
With rib fractures, obviously, you're breathing every few seconds, and every time you take a breath in, it's going to cause pain.
We're then going to pop a tube in on the right-hand side, but with some local anaesthetic and try and numb it up for you as best as we can. Okay.
Emergency doctor Michael Dunn will sedate Belinda before he inserts a tube in her chest to reinflate her lung.
We're going to give you some medications now, OK? Don't want you to worry about any alarms. You're in a safe place, OK?
So just close your eyes. Try and think of something nice and calming and relaxing. You'll have some nice dreams. When you wake up, it'll all be finished, OK? And I'll be here looking after you the whole time.
With ketamine, we always pre-warn our patients that it makes you feel a bit loopy and you might have hallucinations.
If we can pull it out slightly, maybe some pause. OK, that's fine, yeah, good.
Putting a chest tube in is a pretty delicate procedure because it's very easy to nick an artery, to injure a nerve, to put the chest tube into the lung itself, as opposed to into that gap between the lung and the chest wall. So there are complications that can happen.
So she's had 60. I'm just giving another 20. Okay. Nice and relaxed. I'm doing so well.
Ketamine is known traditionally as a horse tranquilizer, but it's actually a great drug for sedating people. It can actually help keep the blood pressure up with people who have a borderline blood pressure. And it definitely allows us to do very painful procedures that people otherwise would tolerate quite poorly.
Well, almost there. One second.
She's in a happy place.
I'm really.
I know, isn't it?
Oh.
Yeah.
Close your eyes for me.
Bit of pressure here, sorry. It's quite deep, rib.
Yeah.
We make an incision just underneath the armpit to allow us to get our finger in and work our way through all the tissue until we get to the rib and go just above the rib into the space between the lung and the ribs.
Sorry, dear.
Pretty tough sometimes getting your finger in there, but we don't want to put anything sharp in there or else we might injure some vessels or damage some structures.
I'm in there.
Where am I?
You're in hospital. Fell off your horse. Fix your lung.
Sometimes people respond poorly to ketamine, but Belinda's certainly not one of those people.
I'm in such a mess, man.
Good job, Belinda.
I'm going to give up to this
one. I think it's good. No, I'm pretty confident. That's the last hole there, so.
Done.
Once the chest tube is in, that allows to remove all the air that shouldn't be there, and that gives the lung room to fully expand again.
You did so well, Belinda. You're a superstar. Mm-hmm, you are.
Okay, I better go see some patients. It's a bit busy. Good job, Michael.
Thanks. Thankfully, her pain seems well controlled, but I'm not sure if she's going to have surgery or not, because she does have quite a few rib fractures.
Hi, I was just coming to see how you're going.
He was standing on a ladder, painting the top of a house, a gutter on the house, and he lost his footing, so he's landed on his heels.
25-year-old Brandon fell 3 metres from the top of an extension ladder while painting guttering. Emergency doctor Miriam Yasser is concerned about Brandon's back.
We need to basically examine him from top to toe. If there's been a lot of damage to the spinal cord, Brandon climbs ladders for a living. He might not be able to do that anymore.
Fallen off ladders multiple times. Was up on the extension ladder and on the way down, just fell off and just didn't land right.
Brandon was transferred from a local hospital to Royal Melbourne Emergency because of the distance of his fall.
I got my old man to drop me off down here, so he took me to the hospital and then he's like, there's no point in me waiting around. I'm like, oh, yeah. He was like, oh, you'll be all right. I like the support, thanks.
We'll organise all your scans and things.
Good, easy.
The CT scan will indicate to us whether or not he has a fracture in his spine. But not only that, it will look to see whether or not the force of the fall has caused any internal bleeding. We'll look at his chest. We'll look inside his brain to make sure that the force of a 3 metre fall hasn't caused any bleeding there.
10 more seconds here, nice and still.
Dr. Miriam has also ordered x-rays of Brandon's injured hand.
And down just like so.
Yep.
All right?
Yep, cool.
The results of Brandon's scans are not what Dr. Miriam expected.
So, from that 3 metre fall, the only injury he's got is a fracture at the top of his left finger. Yep, his spine's fine. His head is fine. So he's lucky. He's lucky. It's unusual that he has managed to escape a serious injury. He needs to stop climbing ladders. I think painting is maybe not the job for him.
Paramedic Ree was bitten by a suspected deadly brown snake while out jogging.
Have you vomited?
Twice.
Okay.
She was flown into the Royal Melbourne Hospital and given anti-venom.
Still feeling okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's that light-headed, fuzzy feeling.
Yeah.
Ree was kept overnight for observation.
Seems like the anti-venom worked and, it's insane. I'm still getting over the fact I stepped on a snake yesterday.
Just that's where it bit me. That's it.
If it had been a decent bite, that would have probably killed me. So I was lucky. Could have been a lot worse.
Belinda suffered multiple rib fractures, a badly broken shoulder, and a punctured lung after a 300-kilogram horse trampled her.
We're going to have to pop a tube in to take the air out.
It's my lung puncture.
It is.
Dr. Michael Dunn and his team were able to stabilise her.
Where am I?
You're in hospital. Fell off your horse.
She was transferred to rehabilitation a week later to continue her recovery.
And do you remember much about the crash?
I remember going over my apple bars and then I sort of black out until I was lying on the ground. Yeah, I landed face first.
Teenage mountain bike riders Ryan and Ollie both crashed on the same mountain in separate accidents a few minutes apart.
Tell them to get help!
Oh, my arms.
Ryan broke both his wrists.
Oh, God. Oh, please.
We really can't wait to sit on this, so we need to get this addressed tonight.
Ollie was sent to surgery for a badly broken leg that was crushing the blood supply to his foot. Several weeks later, Ollie and Ryan have become good friends, brought together by their accidents.
Hey.
Hey, Ryan. Hey, Susan.
Hi.
How
are
you going? Nice to see you. Not bad.
It's not bad.
No, it's looks a lot better than it used to be.
Since his crash, Ollie has had 4 operations on his leg and weeks of rehab.
My recovery was definitely long and sometimes hard, just lying in hospital bed all alone. But I'm happy I'm out of it now. I'm happy I'm up and walking again, even though it's painful.
By comparison, Ryan has come off relatively unscathed.
So this was just the worst broken, but somehow this one ended up with full range of motion again.
And then the one that was broken the least ended up with probably about 30% range.
Ryan is very thankful his helmet protected his head and his insulin pump remained intact when he crashed.
Could have been a lot worse. Like, all the equipment and safety gear that I wore that day did their job.
So this is it?
This is the bike you crashed on? It's actually not in bad shape.
No, so, absolutely nothing.
So where'd your leg go?
I don't know, really.
The boys' passion for mountain bike riding hasn't been dampened by their accidents.
I started riding, like, almost as soon as I got my cast off. It's like I never got off my bike in the first place.
He's got back to school a few
weeks
ago.
Back to school.
For Ollie, it's going to be a while before he's riding again.
Like the whole wheel.
I won't say I won't be nervous, but it's certainly a passion that Ollie has. So if he's given the medical go-ahead, then for sure if that's something he wants to do, I think he'll go and do it.